a little bit more of the Dataverse components within portals, but the idea is that we dive into that through content snippets, then site settings, and then we're going to be looking at entity forms and potentially entity lists. I don't know if we'll get that far, but the idea is that we get started today, and then we continue next week on Dataverse objects. All right. I don't know if everybody got my email about components. I sent a solution file. I think I sent it on Sunday, and I don't know if you got a chance to install. So I'll quickly walk through that process. So if you have received the file and you have a and if you have a your own instance of CDS or Dataverse, here are the steps that you have to complete to get it installed if you haven't yet. So you log on to your environment, then you're gonna click on solutions. And then in solutions, you can click import, select that zip file I sent, and then hit next, and you would get this particular solution file installed to it. So the solution itself has only a handful of entities, and we're gonna use these entities in our demos starting today. So we have the out-of-the-box contact entity, then we have three more entities, course, session, and program. So program is just to outline a program for my virtual school, if you will, and the courses within that program, and then course session would be essentially the participation of a contact or student within a course. All right. Okay, so back to today's lesson. We're gonna look at a content snippet and how we can leverage that within portals. So content snippets, if you are a coder, the keyword snippet will ring a bell for you. It's pretty much pieces of code that you save aside to be reused, not necessarily code reuse, but stuff that you find interesting that you put aside that you can pick and adjust and use on a project, you know. For example, how to read a file from .NET or how to open a network connection. Those things that you always use doesn't really make sense to put into like a class to be used in object orientation, but it's code that you want to plug into something that you may be developing. So that's the idea of a snippet. In portals, that idea is a little different. The content snippet is essentially bits and pieces of or parts of the portal that you want to enable an end user, like a content manager, to change. Be it yourself, you know, you're developing a product and you know that in this area of the site, you want to add the name of the customer. So instead of hard coding the name of a customer in your product, you can then create a content snippet that later on, when you install your product at a customer instance, the customer can go ahead and make the change, or whomever is deploying this can then configure the content snippet to have a different value. Okay, so you can now, if you're following this, you can navigate to Portal Management, the model-driven app, and when you land there, you're gonna access the content snippet area. So in here, there is already a bunch of content snippets. There is one that Portal uses, which is the footer. This guy here, we kind of looked at it last time. We looked at Portal's more of the branding stuff. So if you go to the footer of this website, you see that it loads a snippet. See, footer, content info. And then within the snippet itself, there is another reference to another content snippet. Sorry, within the footer, you see the reference to the content snippet. You see snippet, footer, of type HTML. So here, if you go back to the back end, you see the name of the snippet there and its content. Okay. And if you click on the HTML, you see what it's doing there. All right. So in my example, I've created a page called Snippet Sample. So in there, what I've done is I want to create content for my page, but I wanted to use content snippets so that it's easier for me to either delegate it to a BA or CMS, a person responsible for content here, to come make a change. So if you click on the content of this page, and if you go to the source code, you see that I have some HTML here, and I am referencing a content snippet. So I'm telling that this snippet is editable, which means that a user can click on here and make changes to it. Okay. I could, if I don't want to use the code, I could make the change directly through Studio. Or if I want to see the code, I can click at the source and see the content of my snippet. All right. Or those changes can also be made through the backend. So if I search zero, that's my content snippet. And here's the content. Hello Heroes. I can click on the HTML and we can see the content there. If I didn't want it to be editable, I could just reference the snippet and have as read only on the portal. And it's only editable if the user is logged on as a admin of the portal. Okay. It's not available for the end user to make changes, but I can't actually compose my content snippet. You know, right now it's got some HTML content. If I want, I can say, hello, Victor, and save. I could have it done it through the UI as well. Okay, I'm doing it through the HTML code. If I go back here and reload my content snippet record, you see that it changed. Now it says, hello, Victor. Now, I can also compose my content snippet using Liquid Code. Okay, I can do things like, if user, which tests whether there is a logged on user, and hello to the first line here, then I can say, don't worry too much about the syntax of Liquid. We'll get to it when the time comes. Else, if right, so in other words, what's happening here is I am testing if there is a user logged on. If the user is logged on, I say hello, then I say the full name of the user. If not, I say, hello, hero. Okay. I'll go ahead and save. And you notice that it changed right here because I'm logged on to this portal. Now, if I navigate to portals and I just want to open in incognito browser window, then you see that it shows hello, hero. Okay, so I'm not logged on here. On this one, I'm logged on and it shows my name. So we can compose logic within the content snippet as well. And this comes in very handy if you have this sort of logic happening in other places. You can bring a snippet to a web template and reference that snippet all the time instead of adding this code to all templates. Does that make sense? Or let's say that you want to show a subheader with, the name of the user plus number of courses that user is attending currently. Whatever it is, you can use the snippet as a shortcut to bring those functionality to this type of functionality to your pages. You don't have to code this multiple times. That's to me, it's the power of snippets. That you can have these little parts of your website built onto snippets, and then you can reference that onto your pages. So that's one thing. First thing, snippets. Then let's have a look at site settings. Okay, site settings, they direct a lot of the stuff that happens on portals. Be it for logging. So if I click to log in, you see that I have local signing enable and external signing enable. If I want to disable local authentication or local sign on, I can go back to the portal's backend, navigate to site settings, and then I can navigate to local or filter. Local and say I do not want local logging enabled. Save it. Go ahead. Let's see if this is doing what it's supposed to. Refresh. And now local authentication is gone. All right. It is here also in site settings that Well, originally, that was the area where you would set up external authentication. So if I filter Facebook as an example, those are the key entries for Facebook authentication, Facebook Connect. Well, it used to be called Facebook Connect. If you want to do LinkedIn authentication, it would be here as well. I'll show you another interface that Microsoft just built for local authentication, but I'm trying to illustrate that everything that has to do with settings, you're going to find here in site settings. All right. Also, there are other settings that portal is still sensitive to, if you will, that are not listed as part of the install of portals, but they still function. I believe I shared a link with you from Alexander, where he outlined some of the other site settings that are not part of the install, but are still they are still functional if you want to add it to your portals. Okay. All right. So moving on, let's look at site settings that have to do with authentication. If you want to set up external authentication. So if you click the three dots, and you're going to notice this, if you're using a trial, sometimes I don't know if it was by design or accidentally, but you try to click the three dots and you can't because this shows up, and then you move your mouse and this disappears and you try to click again. So one way to get to it, you can highlight and that way it will stop moving. So anyhow, you can then navigate to settings. And in here, you're gonna click on, I think, Victor, administration. I may be mistaken. Let's go to site settings here. Sorry. So it's administration. Then come on. Where is it, Victor? Do I not have the latest one? Sorry, authentication settings, my bad. So in here, you notice that local authentication is now disabled. I did it through site settings, but it surfaced here as not being available. So whatever you do on this panel is going to translate in site setting records in the backend. So if you're tasked with setting up Azure B2C, you can click here and it's going to ask you for a provider name. Then you can hit next and it's going to guide you through setting up B2C. But essentially, what happens is once you're done with this wizard, a lot of your site setting entries will be updated. So in essence, Microsoft has made it really nice for us to configure identity providers, but the data lives here constantly. All right. The other thing too, though, a lot of people ask me this question. They are setting up portals. They only have one external identity provider. They don't want the users to click sign in, land on this page, and then have to click on this again and then move on to the external provider. I don't know if I shared this with you, but there is one site setting that does the trick for you, and it is this one guy here. Let me move. It's called authentication registration login button type. And all you have to do is you have to put the URL for the particular external identity provider that you want to use. Okay. Once you do that, the moment that you navigate to sign in, portals will push you to the external sign in page. Okay. The users don't have to see this page with just one button. All right. So let's move on to entity forms. All right. First of all, we're gonna navigate to the solution I built, and then we are going to open the contact entity. And look at forms. Let's see what we got here. So I've created a portal contact form, which references fields in the contact entity and other fields from other entities. Okay. So this is pretty basic. This actually, I reference this one from portals. It ships with portals. What I want to do here is I want to save this form and start working on our own version of a contact form or a student form that we are going to reference on portals. All right. So I'm going to save as, call it student form portal. Oops. It's now saved. Hopefully, it's not going to take forever to load. All right. So it's here now. I do not need web authentication on my form. So I can I'll hide this guy for now. Notes and activities we'll leave there. Let's see preferences. I'm gonna hide it as well. And so we have general, which information about the contact. details. Let's leave it there. Okay. So I'm gonna add, let's actually save this one for now. Then we'll publish the form. Again, navigation for this design, it's sometimes it shows the back button, sometimes it doesn't, so it kind of sucks. So we're gonna have to force navigation back to make.powerapps.com. And so I have this form is now published. Okay. I'm gonna go back to my portal page or my go back to studio and move back to the home page. And I'm going to create a page to see my information as if I am a student in this website. So I'm going to create a blank page or a page using the blank template. I'll call this guy student profile. Define the URL student profile. In here, I'm going to add, I'm going to add a form to my page. I'll call this form again student profile. Looking at the contact entity. The form layout is going to be student form, the one that we just created and changed. The mode for this form is going to be edit, because the idea is I'm logged on. I want to see my information and I want to be able to change my data. Okay. Success setting. We can dive into it later on. Enable table permissions. I don't want to do that right now. And hopefully this is saved because we have no control over the save button once again. Okay, so let's click out, save. Now, we went ahead, we created a bunch of things in the back end, and we're gonna see what we created. And this control allowed me to set some things up, but it didn't really allow me to complete this setup all the way as I wanted. For example, if this was an insert mode form, we would be good to go, but because it's edit, I have to tell what is the source of the record. I mean, meaning what's going to provide the ID so I can open a record using this form. And I don't have those properties here, as you can see. So we're going to have to dive into the back end. Again, I go to apps, portal management. Entity forms. Then I have, am I in the right place? Okay, this looks weird. Let me step back, let me make sure I'm in the right instance. Oh yeah, I was in the wrong instance. Sorry about that, folks. All right, apps, portal management. Then I can go to entity forms. I need to see a student profile form. Now here through the back end, I have a lot more settings than I did through Studio. For example, in my scenario, I don't want the record ID to be the source, the record source for my form. I want it to be the user that's logged on, on this particular scenario. Okay, so I can now save, and if everything looks correct, I should see my form. Come on, Studio, where are you? Okay, I should see my form here. Let me refresh the configuration. And I'm still not able to see it. So there is one more detail when it comes to editing, edit form types. I will click on the form. I will say, I need my form to use table permissions. And I need to go back again to the backend and go to permissions and create a permission for my, to be able to access the contact record. Again, some of the stuff we're gonna dive more into as we advance contact scope. Let's do self. I'm gonna read, pen two, and write. And I'll make this available to actually authenticated users. All right, let's go back to Studio. Studio, where are you? Okay, let's browse the site and see if we have our forms. Okay, I cannot see it because I'm not logged on. I'm going to sign in. And we should be able to see our forms. Come on, don't tell me I'm lying. I have to force it with a refresh. Still not. All right, let's go back to entity permissions. I'll do global for now, just to get past the settings. Record you're looking for could not be found. Let's see what this error is about. So my form exists. Okay. Why did it save my settings? Let's refresh. Yeah, it's still pointing to the query string. I think the when I use the Studio interchangeably, it overwrote what I did through the backend. So let's click here again, save. I'll clear the cache and refresh. All right, so here's our form. So all of the fields as we defined, the address components as well, description. It's a huge form, right? It's showing all the tabs in one form. And the reason being is because I have not selected which tab I wanted to display. So if I go ahead and select general on this particular setting, hit save, clear cache, and then preview. Now it's not showing all of the fields, all of the other tabs on my display. Okay, I can make changes to my record. I can hit save. Now it's got reCAPTCHA enabled, and I'll show you where you can disable that. So my information's changed. Let's go back to portal settings and then look at reCAPTCHA. You see, it's got CAPTCHA enabled for authenticated users. I can remove it for authenticated users, and that would cause that particular validation to disappear from the form. Notice that my name changed here because I submitted that one change through the UI, through the form. If I scroll down, CAPTCHA is no longer here. All right. So this particular component comes in very handy because, I mean, you may ship a product that uses forms and maybe the layout of the form changes from customer to customer. So instead of building this all by hand, you can just use entity forms or use the portal technology to surface a form and then let the user decide which layout they want to use. So in my example, I have generic information, then I have address information, then I have description. Let's say that my customer does not want description. So they can go back to the form in Dynamics. Go back to the general tab and say, look, I do not want description as part of my form. So I remove description. I don't want this freight thing either on my form. Okay, so I can save, publish. Then I can clear the cache. Refresh. Then now my form is different. You know, I no longer have those fields. All right. Other features here. You can do validation. You can set up CSS to present your validations differently. You can add instructions to your form. It would show up top on the form. Quick explanation on how the user should or should not fill out this form. So on and so forth. Moving on to success settings. You can hide the form when the submit is successful, or you can just display the success message and still leave the form open. I'll do that. Other additional settings, you can configure the label on the buttons that you display on the record. So on the submit button, I don't want it to call submit. I want to call it update. If you have a workflow, a Dataverse workflow that you want to invoke as well, you can click and surface that action onto portals as well in the record. Activate, deactivate, you can do all those things through this form. Entity reference, I think I'll wait to explain this a little more later on as you expose yourself in using entity forms. And entity metadata, we're going to look at it next week. There was one part that I skipped here on form options, which is attachments. You can, let me see, where is that at? It's right here. You can enable attachment on a form by clicking this option. You can do multiple files. You can select what type of files you want to allow as part of the upload. You can give it the file types here. If not, you can use MIME types as well for the upload. Add a label to your file attachment component. And even make the file upload part of it required if your business requirements outline that. If there is an error uploading a file, you can customize the error. You can define the size of the attachments that you want to allow on your portals. You can enable geolocation. What it means is when you submit a form, it would collect the location of the person submitting that form. This comes in handy if you are implementing a solution for like a 311 services where people are reporting, a light pole is not working in my city. So as soon as you report the problem, the form would be able to locate, to geolocate that input. And then last but not least, you can add custom JavaScript onto this form. Say that you have a JavaScript library that displays time zone in another way other than this dropdown. So you can leverage the content of the dropdown, use your JavaScript to format and present this component another way. So you can use the JavaScript box here to do that. Only alert I will give you is that always wrap your JavaScript on that ready event if you're using a jQuery to ensure that you load your customization once the DOM of the form is completely loaded. Okay. Let's see what else we got here. Yeah, I think that's it for form. So save, I will clear the cache and reload the form. Did I not save the file requirement? I thought I did. So let's step back. Additional settings. Yeah, attach file. It's all marked. Okay, make it required. Save. Let's clear cache. Refresh my form. For somehow it didn't pick up my file upload. I have to look at why. We are a little bit past, well, close to the time. Let me save here, see if it's going to show up my file upload. Not really. We'll leave file upload for the next lesson, I suppose. Oh yeah, maybe that's why. Or there's another problem with file upload when you don't have notes enabled on your entity. But yeah, we'll give a top down on file upload next time we meet. All right, I'm gonna open the mic. We only have a few more minutes for anybody who may have questions on this one. Anyone? You can pose the question or use the chat. I think Thiago had one. Try to use solutions package, but I couldn't find an option to add the portal. Thiago, I'm not sure if you're still online. If you are, I think the first part is installing portals. You're going to click new app and then click to add a portal. We saw that on the first lesson. The second part is you navigate to solutions, then you click import, select the zip file I sent to you, and then you can just advance, hit next, and that should do the trick for you. Okay. Anybody else? Well, if nobody has questions, I am going to drop and we'll connect again next week. Sunil, do you have any questions?
No, I'm good. I just wanted to say thanks.
All right, thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, sir.
Thank you. Well, if you go through this exercise and if you have questions, don't hesitate to ask. We can step through them as you advance on your exercises. But let me know how it's going. All right.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, thanks.